There'll be no detours in heaven, no ruffles along the way. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. My last stop is heaven's sweet day. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. But you. Cross the Red Sea of destruction, for God was there to see them through. There'll be no detours in heaven, no rough road along the way. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. My last stop is heaven some sweet day. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. Ten commandments tell me what to do. The 12 disciples on my roadside, and God will see me safely through. There'll be no detours in heaven, no rough roads along the way. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. My last stop is heaven some sweet day. There'll be no detours in heaven, no rough roads along the way. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. My last stop is heaven some sweet day. My last stop is heaven some sweet day.
Y'all know this next song, I can't even walk without him holding my hand. That's all of us. The only difference is some of us don't realize it, but that's all of us. Some people don't realize it. They think they can do it on their own, and I think we've all been there too, but y'all pray for us as we try to sing this.
I thought number one would surely be me. I thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build whole life sinking sand. But I can't even walk without you holding. I thought I had done a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but I can't even walk without you holding. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I think I'll make Jesus my own. I'm in trouble, on his name I'll call. If I didn't trust him, I'd be less of a man. 'Cause I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding. The mountains too high.
so much. If you enjoyed that, say amen. Amen. I enjoyed it. Have your Bibles turned to John's Gospel, chapter 16. John's Gospel, chapter 16. No offense to Debbie and Donnie, because I like the way they do that song, but the first time I ever heard that song, Donnie, it was Charles Johnson and the Revivers, a black group out of Durham, North Carolina. Man, if you want to hear that song, that's a good version. That's a good version. John's Gospel, chapter 16. I'm going to spot read some verses tonight, and we're going to look at some things that Christ promises the disciples just before he is to go away and prepare a place for them. I want us to look at, we'll begin the reading, I think, in verse number 7, John 16, let's pick it up in verse 5. But now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you asketh me, whither goest thou? But because I've said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. Now look at verse number 13. Howbeit when he, not it, but when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. And then look at verse 22. And ye now therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you. May God add his blessings and understanding to the reading of his precious, precious word. If you go back to John's Gospel, chapter 14, you see where Jesus begins to prepare his disciples for the fact that he's going to be leaving very soon. And you know the passage very well. I read it at Martha's funeral this past Sunday. I don't know, I think it was at the graveside, but I read it at her funeral. You know, and he says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And so he's beginning to prepare the disciples, the apostles, for his departure. Then he reminds them of the power of prayer. I'm not going to read all these verses. You can do that later. Maybe just jot them down. But in verses 12 through 14, he begins to remind them of the power of prayer. And then he challenges them to keep his commandments. Look at verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. In the Greek, it says, if you really love me, and that's that Greek word agape, if you have a real, genuine love for me, that self-sacrificial divine love, if you have a real love for me, you will be, in the Greek, in the habit of keeping my commandments, or some people translate it this way, that you will habitually keep my commandments. It's not something that's out of the ordinary for you. It's something that is that it's a part of your daily life, your daily routine, that you are striving to habitually keep the commandments of God. Why? Because you love him, and nothing pleases you more than pleasing him. And then you get to verse number 15. After that, then you got the promise that he's going to send the Comforter, and then he departs. Look at this. He says, and I will pray the Father, verse 16, and he shall give you another Comforter that he may abide with you forever, even that Spirit of truth. And in the Greek, it's basically saying this, I'm going to send you another Comforter. He will be one just like me, another Comforter exactly like me, except for the fact that Jesus was in a bodily form. He was God in the flesh, and the Spirit of God will be God in the person of the Holy Spirit. Notice I said person. Then you get to chapter 15. Christ reminds his disciples that he is the vine, they are the branches, and without him they can do absolutely nothing. That's the first 8 verses of chapter 15. Then Christ reminds his disciples to continue in his love in verse number 9. Dr. James Zaspel said years ago when I was over at Grace Baptist Church, he came in to preach revival, and I remember him saying this, I'm pretty sure from the pulpit, but he said, one of the signs that people are really saved is if they are continuing in God's word and continuing in God's love, and that's been shown in their faithfulness. You know, faith without works is dead, and so on and so forth. But those who continue in God's love, those are the ones that have the testimony anyway, that they really love the Lord and that they really have a relationship. So he reminds them to continue in his love. And then he says this, he reminds them to keep his commandments and abide in his love, verses 9 through 11. And finally, in the latter part of chapter 15, finally, Christ tells his tells his disciples in verse number 26, that when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. Now look at that verse again. When the Comforter, that's going to be the Holy Spirit, is come, whom I will send, Christ is going to send him unto you from the Father. You've got God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, all mentioned in that one verse. Now we can, that's kind of the background here just a little bit. As we get into chapter 16, there's two noteworthy things I want to mention, still in introduction, but two noteworthy things to mention here in chapter 16. First, the timing of this discourse. The timing of this discourse. And I've told you already what's leading up to chapter 16, but if you would just think about this, in chapter 17, we have that high intercessory prayer of Christ. If you want to know what the real Lord's Prayer is, it's John 17, and I think we all know that. And it can be broken into three parts. First, Christ prays for the relationship that he has with the Father. And then after that, he prays for the relationship he has with his disciples, the apostles. And then lastly, he prays for all believers, the believers who are on the earth then, future believers. And the main thing he prays concerning believers is that they would be in unity. And he talks about how unity amongst the believers displays the reality that God sent Christ to be here on the earth and to save us from our sin. So that's John chapter 17. I believe, by the way, that he prayed that prayer in the upper room, and then he left the upper room after that prayer, went across the Kidron Valley. I'm looking for some people that might have gone to Israel with us. I'm trying to, anybody here been to Israel with us? I'm looking to see. Heston, did y'all get to go? Not with us, but did y'all get to go to Israel? Did you get to go to Jerusalem, the old city of Jerusalem? So when you come out of the upper room, you go toward the eastern wall, you go down across the Kidron Valley where that Muslim cemetery is. You go down across the main drag there, the main street, and you go up on the Mount of Olives, and that's where the Garden of Gethsemane is. And I believe Christ left the upper room and went down that road there across the Kidron Valley, which would have been just a little valley and a creek in those days, the brook Kidron, and he crossed that little branch there, and he went over into the Mount of Olives, and he went to the Garden of Gethsemane, and that's where he prayed. So I'm telling you the timing of all this. Christ knows that very soon he's going to be arrested, tried, and crucified. So he's preparing his disciples. It's important to understand that he knows what's about to happen to him, and he is preparing his disciples. He is telling them those things that are most important, and we need to understand that. So chapter 17 is that high intercessory prayer. Chapter 18, Christ is arrested, and then he's tried. Chapter 19, we know he's crucified. And chapter 20, he's risen from the grave. Praise God. So chapter 16 is Christ preparing his disciples for everything that's about to take place, but especially for his departure, because he knows he's going to be crucified, risen on the third day, on the earth for 40 days, and then he's going to be gone, and they're going to be left here to carry on the work that Christ has started and that he has prepared them for some 3.5 years. Now, in Ephesians chapter 4, I failed to mark this, and I need to get back there and read a little bit here. But in Ephesians chapter 4, let me get back there, verses I got a marker that I'm going to have to move here. But Ephesians chapter 4, I think it's verses 11 and 12. Let me get over there. We're talking about the equipping or the perfecting of the saint. Look at verse number 11 and 12, Ephesians chapter 4. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. In the Greek, that's one office, pastor, teacher. For what purpose? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. That word perfecting translates equipping. He gives them these positions, these gifts, if you will, for the equipping of the saints is what he's trying to say here. Now, I read it again. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastor teachers for the perfecting, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying, the building up of the body of Christ. Now, in John 16, I want us to look at six promises. There's actually seven. I left one out because it's so controversial that I just didn't even want to deal with it. And there's six promises that I want to talk to you about. And may not get through all these tonight, but if we do, that's fine too. First of all, I want you to notice in verse number 7, and I just read it to get this thing started, but let's look at it again. John chapter 16, verse number 7. Christ says this, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him to you." Now think about this. "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you." He sent here. "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth." It fascinates me that Christ, who is truth, has to reassert the fact that he is telling the truth. You think about if I were to ask, and please don't raise your hand, but if I were to ask in this congregation for a show of hands, I'm not, and I said, "How many of you never told a lie in your whole life?" And somebody slipped up your hand, I'd say, "You're lying." And we all would, wouldn't we? Because no doubt everybody in this room has told a lie. But Christ never told a lie. He is walking truth. He is the very epitome of truth. Would you agree with that? Somebody say amen. And so here he is again reassuring his disciples that he is telling them the truth. Remember, he's God in the flesh, and with God it is impossible for him to lie. Not difficult, not tricky. It is impossible for him to lie. It's the total opposite of a politician. I just said that joking, all right? But it is impossible for him to lie. But he's reassuring the apostles. He said, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth." So notice that Jesus also, as he's talking about telling the truth, he says this in Hebrews 6:18, "Now where he is the Spirit of truth." Where he is the Spirit of truth. Think about that. Now, I'm going to say this. I believe that once a person is saved and has the Holy Spirit of God inside of them, I believe if that person will pray that God's going to give him all the wisdom he needs to do whatever he needs and get into that truth that Christ is talking about. But look what he says here. "I tell you the truth." Now think about this as well. Matthew 1:23, Jesus said this, "I tell you the truth." And once again, this is Jesus, and I've already said it again, God in the flesh. He says, "Emmanuel," which is being interpreted, God with us. We know he's the truth. And then Jesus says in John 14:6, I just touched on it, "He is the way, the truth, and the life." Reminding his disciples that he's telling the truth. I want to add just one thing to this. Romans 3:4 said, "If God be true," it said, "God be true, let every man be a liar." Romans 3:4. "Let God be true, but every man a liar." I'm going to say this again. I've probably said it 100 times. Anything that contradicts the word of God is indeed a lie. To that, I will add this. Anyone, any person who contradicts the word of God is indeed a liar. If my word contradicts the word of God, I am the liar because it's impossible for him to lie. Amen? And so here's Christ the truth, the way, the truth, and the life, and he's trying to reassure these people, these disciples, that what I'm about to tell you is the truth. And here's what he says. He says, this comforter, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it's expedient. That word expedient means advantageous. It is to your advantage that I depart, that I go away. For because if I don't go away, the comforter cannot come. But if I do go away, if I depart, the comforter will come, because I'm going to send him to you after I go away. The comforter I mentioned already is another one Christ is saying. He's another one exactly like me. His ministry would be much like mine. Now remember, this is very simple stuff, but we know that we worship one God in three persons. So here we have God in the flesh, Christ, returning to heaven, the place where Almighty God resides, so that God, the Holy Spirit, can come to the earth and do what God has called him to do, do those things that is the ministries, if you will, of the Holy Spirit of God. I want you to note also that Christ calls the Holy Spirit him, not it. There's other religions that will tell you that the Holy Spirit is an it, or that the Holy Spirit is some kind of force. The Holy Spirit is not some kind of force or it or a thing. The Holy Spirit is a person, a part of the Trinity, a part of the Godhead. There is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, three in one, amen? And so some people would say God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. No, they're co-equal, co-eternal, co-powerful, co-existent. They are all part of the Godhead. We serve one God in three persons, and the Comforter is just as much God as Christ is God, and Christ is just as much God as Almighty God is God. They are three in one. And Christ here calls him. He's a part of the Trinity. It is the Holy Spirit of God. I'll just touch on two or three things here, and then we move on to point two. But it is, I believe with all my heart, that is God the Holy Spirit who convicts us of our sin, who convinces us of our need for a Savior, and then once we're saved, he indwells every believer. Amen? You know that nobody can be saved if you are not convicted of your sin, because the first thing you need to do to be saved is realize you're a sinner, right? First thing you need to do. And nobody can be convicted of their sin except the Holy Spirit convicts them. And so it's that Holy Spirit of God that convicts us, makes us realize that we are sinful man, and then without God, without Christ, that we'll never see heaven. If we don't confess our sin and ask God to forgive us our sin and come into our heart, we know that we cannot escape hell. And so it's the Holy Spirit of God that convicts people, all people, of their sin. And it's also the Holy Spirit of God that convinces of our need for a Savior. But we have to believe also that once he convicts us of our sin, convinces us of our need for a Savior, which would cause us to pray a prayer of repentance. And once we pray that prayer, if we mean that prayer, if from not from the mind but from the heart, we call upon God, we repent of our sin, confess it, we repent of it, and ask Christ to come in our heart, be our Savior, the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And we understand that, we believe that, and we know that nobody can come without the drawing of the Holy Spirit. And so it's that Holy Spirit that draws us unto the Father. But then once we're saved, it's that Holy Spirit of God who indwells every believer. So number one, the thing that Christ is preparing his apostles for, he's saying that, he said, I'm going to go away so the Comforter can come. And the Comforter's another one just like me. When Christ was here on the earth, he was the one, as he preached and he taught, and his very words convicted people of their sin, and his very presence convicted them of their sin, and his preaching and teaching and so on. But now as he goes away, the Holy Spirit of God will do that. Second thing in verse number 13, look at it. I love this verse. Verse number 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. And that's all. I'm just going to read the first half of that verse. He will guide you into all truth. Once again, Christ refers to the Holy Spirit as a him, not an it. But I want you to notice also that Jesus He's telling the truth. It is impossible for him to lie. I want you to get that concept, because there are religions now that will tell you that Christ was not perfect, and that we can't really fully expect for anybody that ever lived on the earth to be perfect, including Christ. That he was just a pop prophet. He was a good teacher. He was a good preacher. Some will even go as far as to say the Jehovah's Witnesses, for example, they will say he was the Son of God, but he was not God in the flesh. He was simply the Son of God. And because he was not God in the flesh, he had the potential to sin. So there's all these things. So I'm just trying to get you, Christ is reminding his apostle, I am telling you the truth. What I'm telling you, he said, I am promising you, I am telling you the truth. Now, when politicians, some of them, make promises, they are very vain promises. I was telling Bob and Charles and Judy back there before church started, I said, if I were president, which you better be glad I'm not, but if I were president, the second thing I would do, the first thing I would do is most likely I would stop abortion. I know I would stop federally funding abortion, but I'd probably try my dead level best to stop abortion. But anyway, the second thing I might do is that I might take the truth in advertising law and make sure it applies to everybody, including politicians, right? I mean, you'll hear politicians, man, they'll lie and get away with it, and nobody calls them on it. If I were to try to sell a product on television and I lied about it and somebody bought my product and it didn't do what they said, they could sue me and get their money back or whatever. But politicians, man, they'd just soon lie as eat, I think, you know? And you know what I'm talking about. So I'm just simply saying that some people, they just lie. But here, the Holy Spirit of God is promising it. Now, I'm going to tell you something else. There's everyday people that will tell lies. I'm going to tell you something that may shock you. Sometimes there's Christians that may tell you a lie. I'm going to tell you something else. Sometimes there's preachers that might tell you a lie. You ever heard any preachers on television or radio say something that you know contradicts the Word of God? You've heard that. And so when they contradict the Word of God, what are they? They're a liar. You know, and so when we make a promise, sometimes it's not 100% sure that it's going to come true. But when Jesus makes a promise, it is 1,000,000% true that it's going to come to pass. It's going to be true, because he cannot lie. You think about in the Old Testament, they use the word decree. A king would decree something. And when he decreed it, he would take his signet ring, and there would, you know, he would have the scrolls there, and they would roll up the scrolls, and they would put that seal on it. Maybe it was a hot wax or something like that, and they would seal the scroll with that hot wax, and then he would take his signet ring, and he would impress his signet in that hot wax as he sealed that scroll, whatever it was, and he is decreeing something, and when he makes a decree, it couldn't be broken. Did you know that the king that had Daniel thrown in the lion's den didn't really want Daniel thrown in the lion's den? But once he made that decree that nobody could pray or make any kind of petition to anybody but him, and then those tattletales come, hey, we saw Daniel praying. You know, of course, they saw him praying beforehand. It was all a racket just to get Daniel. And we saw Daniel praying, and the king had already made the decree. What was his name? Darius? He'd already made the decree. And so he couldn't break the decree. But I guarantee you, if you study throughout history, there were some kings that broke a decree, right? They broke a decree. They broke it. But Christ, when he makes a promise, it's absolutely 1,000,000,000% that it's going to happen, because he cannot lie. And we need to understand, we need to grasp what Christ is saying here. He's telling these disciples, you need to get ready for something. You need to understand something. You need to have these truths in your minds and your heart, because I'm getting ready to leave, and you're not going to have me here to call on physically in the person. You're not going to have me here physically to call on. But he says, I'm going to leave another one. I'm going to send another one that's just like me. His name is the Holy Spirit, and he's going to be just like me. And he says this. Look at it in verse 13. He says, when the Spirit of truth has come, he will guide you into all truth. He will guide you into all truth. Now, I started to touch on this a minute ago, about got out of place. But I believe if I sit down and start to read my Bible and I want to understand it, that I need to pray first. Say, God, I'm here, Lord. And go through whatever process you go through. Confess your sins. Praise the Lord. Confess your sin, and then ask God to lead you and guide you and direct you through the study of His Word. Lord, show me something. Show me what I need to understand. Lord, if you would just show me. Lord, help me to understand those things that I'm ready to understand. Because I'm ready to understand things now, Chris, that I couldn't understand 30 years ago. You know, and as we mature in Christ, there's going to be things we understand later on that we don't understand now. So as we grow in Christ, mature in Christ, He's going to give us a better understanding. But I think if we read God's Word, study God's Word, and pray before we read God's Word, He will guide us into all truth. He will help us understand the truths that are in God's Word. So first there's a promise of the Comforter. Then there's the promise of guidance and teaching. And I don't have a problem with people using other study books. I mean, I use them myself. J. Vernon McGee and Bible Knowledge Commentary, Dr. Oliver B. Green and Warden Wiersbe and David Jeremiah, and it goes on and on and on. But the best teacher of the Word of God is the Holy Spirit of God, as we pray. Third thing and last thing. I want you to see the promise of His coming again in verse 22, if we have time. Verse 22. And ye now therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you. I want to turn back and read 1 Thessalonians. You know this passage. We're talking about the second coming of Christ. You know, we've got the secret coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ. I guess this would be the secret coming of Christ, but it's where Christ is going to step out on the cloud. He will not step on the earth, but He will step out on the cloud. I personally believe this is going to take place before the tribulation. So 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, you've heard it read many times, but Paul says to the church at Thessalonica, he said, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep. And we know that's talking about those who have died. He said, those which are asleep, that you sorrow not even as others which have no hope. Aren't you glad we have hope? I have hope, amen. I have hope that when this body goes to sleep, when this body dies, that my soul, my spirit will be instantly with God. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I'll be with the saints in glory. And so he says, Don't sorrow like those who have no hope. Why? Because if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, class, do you believe that? You believe Jesus died and rose again? Amen, I do. If you believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which sleep, those who have died, in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. Paul says, I'm not making this stuff up. I didn't get this from secular books. I didn't get this from anybody else. This we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent. It means precede. We shall not precede them which are asleep, or we shall not precede those who have died. Why? Because the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up. That's where we get that idea of rapture. It means to be snatched away. We shall be caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. Matthew 25:13, I believe it is, says, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. So we know he's coming back again. We just don't know when, so we better be prepared. Now here Christ tells his disciples, hey, you might be sorrow now. Remember, he's beginning to prepare them for his departure. And he told them in John 14, hey, I'm going to go away for a while. I'm going away. I'm going to prepare a place for you that where I am, you can be there also. And I'm going away for a little while and I'm coming back. They didn't know how long a little while was. You know, a day with Christ is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. And I keep reminding you, if you look at it that way, it's only been 2 days since we hung his son on a cross, right? And so there's times just not really relevant to the Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes I think it's not relevant with Richard Badger because he's never been on time anywhere we go. I'm joking a little bit when I say that. But think about it, if you will. He says, right now, he said, I'm telling you that I'm going to be gone for a while, and you haven't seen the Holy Spirit yet. You haven't felt his presence. You don't know. You're puzzled about all that. So I know right now you're sorrowing. But he assures them, he promises them that they're going to see him again. And look at the verse again. He says it, and you, he says, now, he says, therefore you have sorrow, but I will see you again. And when I see you again, your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you. Two noteworthy things. Their heart shall rejoice. It means to be glad. It means to rejoice exceedingly, to thrive at rejoicing. Bob thrives at golf. I mean, he can hit, I mean, probably not as long as you two. Bob, but I've seen you hit it, what, 350 more than one time, right? Right in the middle. I've seen him do that. I used to thrive, Ted, I used to thrive at basketball. I love softball. I guess that's the thing that I could help my team with a bit. But I like to play basketball better than I like to play softball, even though I didn't play as much. And, man, Steve, in my day, I could jump up with the best of them, you know, and I put my elbow on the rim. And now I try to go up, my belly goes down, it's embarrassing, you know? But I could thrive at basketball, and Bob could thrive at golf. Michael Jordan could thrive at basketball, maybe better than any person I've ever seen. And here he's saying that he says, you're gonna have joy, you're gonna rejoice exceedingly to thrive at rejoicing. You know, I thought about, I'm looking for some of these teachers who might've been here years and years and years ago. Tiny, you probably taught some of the little kids, and I'm trying to look around and see who else. Ernestine, you might have. Carolyn, you might have. But y'all remember we used to have the little kids, and we would sing, it's bubbling, it's bubbling, it's bubbling in my soul. They're singing and shouting, since Jesus made me whole. Some folks don't understand it, but I just can't keep it quiet. It's bubbling, 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 bubbling day and night. That's just a lot of joy, and the joy is just bubbling over and over. I can just see Granny clapping now. I got that joy, 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 joy down in my heart, right? And so we're just overflowing with joy, overfilled with joy. When we see him again, it is going to be, we're going to be so full of joy that we won't know what to do with ourselves. He said, you shall rejoice exceedingly. And then he says, when you see me and you're rejoicing, he said, understand this, at that time, no man can take your joy away from you. No man can take your joy away from you. I'm going to turn back and read Galatians chapter 5. Verses 22 and 23, we talk about the fruit, singular, of the Spirit. And here are those nine elements of one fruit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. There's nine of them. The second one, the Spirit of love, J. Vernon McGee says this. He said that the fruit of the Spirit is love. And out of this flows all the other elements of love. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. If joy is part of one of the elements of the fruit of the Spirit, and every believer has the Holy Spirit of God dwelling in them, we all have joy in us in the person of the Holy Spirit, right? I mean, because we have the Holy Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is, one of the elements is joy. Now let me say this. You can enjoy real joy as long as you're in fellowship with the Father. Now, if the Holy Spirit of God is inside of you and you sin, it's that Holy Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit of God doesn't just convict you to bring you into a relationship with Christ and with God the Father. The Holy Spirit of God, after he indwells you and you sin, he will convict you of your sin. And if you can sin and it doesn't bother you, you probably don't have the Holy Spirit of God inside of you. You might want to have a heart checkup. But he convicts us of that sin. But you can have real joy from the very moment you're saved. You have the potential to have real joy from then on, as long as you're in fellowship with the Father. I jotted this down, and I'll close with it. A child of God can never completely lose their joy because it's one of the nine elements of the fruit of the Spirit. As long as you have the Spirit of God inside of you, you have the potential to have real joy. Now, there's a difference between joy and happiness. Happiness can be faked, but I don't think real joy can. Years ago, I worked at Gilbarco. Matter of fact, I was coming back to the parking deck today at Cone Hospital. I'd gone in to pray with Roger and Regina, and I was going back through the parking deck, top level, and I was admiring this beautiful gray Tacoma pickup truck, and I went by, and a guy stepped out of a young black, well, not so young, but a black gentleman stepped out. He said, "Hey." I said, "Yeah." He said, "You used to work at Gilbarco." And I said, you're right, I did. I said, "Did you?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "I'm Tony." And I got a look. I said, you're Tony Banks. You're Tony Banks. He said, "Yeah, I'm Tony Banks." And so Tony and I began to talk about the old days at Gilbarco. And old days at Gilbarco, we had this fellow that was married to a Christian lady, and he wasn't, we'll just say his name was Joe. But he wasn't saved. And I got the impression, I never met his wife, never met his wife's dad, but she went to church every Sunday with her dad. And Joe's side of the story was, they try to shove God down my throat, and I'm sick and tired of it, and I don't want to hear it no more. He said, "I don't want to be around, you know, all the stuff you hear. I don't want to be around those hypocrites," and blah, blah, blah. And he was just as resentful as he could be. And he was all the time complaining about, "I wish they'd leave me alone," so on and so on and so forth. And he pretended to be the happiest guy in the world. And he comes in one Friday, and he said, "Well, I finally got what I wanted." And he made it real loud so everybody could hear him, you know, on the line. And he said, "My wife served papers on me. She's ready to divorce me. I couldn't be happier to get rid of her." And I'm the happiest I've ever been. I'm finally going to get rid of that woman. Well, we had to work Saturday the next day, and our supervisor called us over near his office, and he said, "I don't know how many of you are people who pray, but you need to pray for Joe. He went home and shot himself in the head last night, and he's in the hospital in ICU. They don't know if he's going to make it." You know what? He pretended to be happy. You can fake happiness, but he didn't have joy. And if you got a relationship with Christ, you can have real joy. Amen. And it's like that peace. It's you know, Christ said that He's going to give, the Holy Spirit's going to give you a peace. It's a peace, and I'll talk about this later, but it's a peace that the world can't give and the world can't take it away. And joy is the same way. Nobody can take your joy away if you have a relationship with Christ, because you've got the Holy Spirit of God dwelling inside of you. And no matter what comes your way, the Holy Spirit of God can get you, and His Word can get you through anything you face. A Christian should never be overcome. I know we're temporarily overcome at times, but when you think about the relationship we have with God, and when you think about, think about this, children, we've got God inside of us, amen? Do you understand that? And in the Holy Spirit, we've got the same God who created the entire universe and sustains it. He is inside of every believer. And if you've got God inside of you, you have power to overcome any situation if you will depend on the Lord. Amen. Amen. Three promises we got tonight. We'll look at three more next Wednesday night, Lord willing. And go ahead and read the rest of the chapter, John 16. See if you can find what those other promises are. And if you do, if you find them, text me or email me and let me know what they are. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your many blessings. I thank you for the privilege I have to preach your word. I don't take it lightly. I love to read it. I love to study it. And most of the time, I love to put it into practice. Sometimes it's difficult. And I confess that right here in front of these people. And if all of them be honest, they'd all tell you that it is. It's hard to love a neighbor sometimes when he's doing everything he can to offend you. And Lord, things like that. But Lord, I love to read your word. And I do love to study it. And I love to share it with people. And I pray that something that's been said, and more importantly, something that's been read, has really spoken to the hearts of people here tonight, whether to be here in person or watching on Facebook or maybe watching on YouTube later. Lord, help us be reminded that as long as we've got God inside of us, there's nothing the world can throw at us with that we can't overcome. If God be for us, who can be against us? And we can take great comfort in that. Bless us now as we go our separate ways. I pray you give us a good night's rest. Help us to wake up in the morning ready to serve you just because we love you. And pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. Give me time to get to the back door and you're dismissed.